Hi everyone, Squint here, and I'm back after a brief hiatus of watching Games Done Quick to get back in the groove of learning fighting games. I didn't play any all last week just because I was watching all the speed runs. But I've already had two sessions this week, and now I'm recording this video entitled Hard Reads: Why Getting Bodied Is Good for You by Corey Gaming. They make great stuff. I don't have to tell you that, I'm sure. Very high production value. So they're very easy to enjoy, very easy to recommend too. It's got a very like documentary feel, which makes it easy to watch. So I of course have been getting bodied in Street Fighter V, which is like kind of the game I'm focusing on. If you were actually the stream from last night, I tried out Fantasy Strike, just for kind of a change of pace, trying to get back in the groove. And it was I enjoyed it. It was fun. It was an execution. It's an execution light fighting game where it kind of boils down the motion inputs so that you can concentrate on like the fundamental decision making in it, like in any fighting game, the kind of decisions you have to make, throw, jump, block, stuff like that. And there's a like kind of a spectrum between your dive kicks and even your footsies, which do teach fundamentals, but they're teaching like spacing. But then like you have Fantasy Strike, which actually introduces some like diversity of moves, which will kind of be the next step up. So it's a interesting kind of if you've been playing fighting games a lot, and I'm sure you've heard of Fantasy Strike if you're into fighting games, and you haven't tried it. It's free to play on Steam, and you can kind of like take a step back and see just like kind of go back to the basics, but maybe you don't want to go all the way back to like a dive kick situation. But anyway, enough preamble out of me. Let's watch this video, and you're welcome to join me. All right, let's go.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Are you going after his paws, bro?
The best matches in fighting games are the ones where you don't know which player is stronger. The games go back and forth as they gradually learn each other's patterns and habits. Only one person can win the set, but that doesn't mean they'll win the next one.
And those are real tears right there.
These good matches are the ones we remember most. But because fighting games are so fast and so complex, these matches can be rare. Everyone will experience one-sided sets.
That was supposed to be his round, dude.
And it's important to be able to learn from and have fun with them, whether you're the stronger player or the weaker one. I'm Patrick Miller.
I think it was a I don't know if that was just an overly aggressive for its own sake, or if he was actually mad, but it was an interesting handshake. I don't know if I'd want to shake somebody who has a reputation for doing that.
For Corey Gaming, and this is why getting bodied is good for you. Finding good matches in IRL fighting games, or martial arts, is hard because you have to balance for both skill and physical ability. If you sign up for a competition, you'll be grouped with other players by age, weight, and gender. But if you're just practicing in the gym, you'll be sparring with people of all different levels and body types, so you might not have many good matches.
So that's an interesting thing. To analogize it to fighting games, whenever I play online, so far, I've only played in ranked. I haven't played in casual matches. So, if you're not playing, and the main reason I'm playing in ranked is because I do want to be against people of roughly equivalent skill to me. And I know that if I go into casual play, I could be playing against anybody, somebody who's been playing Street Fighter V since it first came out. And the main reason is if I'm going to be playing against people, I want to have like a consistency of practice as much as I can, where especially if you're going to be playing against somebody for one match, one like what is that? At most, it would be 3 rounds against an individual before they disappear off the face of the earth. And in that time, it may take that long just to figure out, okay, here's what the person's habits are. So with that in mind, here's what I can practice against them. So it can be hard because you can't communicate with these people. They're not your, you know, your training partners or anything. The only thing that both sides assume is the other person's trying to win first and foremost. Maybe they're trying to practice stuff, but even then, if you're fighting in a match, even a casual match, you're supposed to place winning above everything else, even though both of us, you and I, have already seen videos together where they say one of the best ways to practice playing online is to not focus on trying to win. You know, if you win, that's great, but you should be focusing on bolstering up your weaknesses. But that can take, that can be difficult if you're constantly trying to adjust to different opponents who are doing different things and you never get any like baseline going. That's why, you know, that's why the lab is important. That's why sometimes I spend entire sessions just in the lab working on muscle memory, because at least then I know it's more consistent. But anyway, I've been talking a lot, so let's keep going.
As my coaches used to say, some days you're the hammer, other days you're the nail. If you played fighting games in arcades back in the day, this will sound familiar, because most times you were just lucky if you had someone else to play with, never mind finding someone close to you in skill. When I played Capcom vs. SNK2 at the UC Berkeley Bearcade, rest in peace, I would either make a dollar last for an hour bodying scrubs, or be blowing my weekly token budget losing to Ricky Ortiz, John Choi, Leezy, Senor Payaso, and a bunch of other NorCal CBS2 killers. Now we have fighting games with online matchmaking, and when we get into a match and get blown up, we'll often blame the matchmaker. Matchmaking systems in fighting games generally have to balance three factors: internet latency, time spent waiting in queue, and each player's skill rating. When you click play, the matchmaker will look for low lag matches with people close to your skill rating. And as you wait longer, the matchmaker will relax its definition of low lag and close in skill, so you aren't waiting forever for your perk.
A Brazilian Ken is coming your way. I learned about Brazilian Kens just trial by fire. I got a Brazilian Ken of my very own playing ranked. And yeah, the stories are true. Brazilian Ken has some wild teleportation abilities. And whenever I'm playing against somebody who's laggy, okay, let me gather my thoughts. When I would watch matches like on YouTube, before I started really playing for myself, I'd see these little hitches. And I've played online other online games before. Those little hitches aren't a big deal. And when people would complain about the little hitches, I'd be like, well, that's kind of nitpicky, you know, it's maybe some lag is to be expected. But then it's different. I learned firsthand, like, no, those little hitches are a big deal because fighting games are so timing based. And if what you're seeing on the screen is herkin' and jerkin' around and it's throwing off your button presses and suddenly you're dropping combos, you're dropping motion inputs, you can't react to what's happening, and suddenly their foot's already in your face, you didn't even have time to block, and yeah, it adds up very quickly, and it's frankly, it's not fun. So I'm a little bit older, I'm a little bit wiser, and now I can commiserate with the saga of Brazilian Kens jumping into your fight queue.
Perfect match. This is one reason why fighting games need good netcode and crossplay. However, even games with healthy player bases often make matches that feel unfair. Ideally, a matchmaker is supposed to pair you with someone that you have a 50% chance of beating. So when it makes a bad match and you get destroyed, you either feel like you don't belong at your skill division, or you feel that your opponent doesn't belong there because they're secretly a strong player that just wants to pick on newbies. Here's the thing. I've watched a lot of newer players play.
All right, so I've definitely felt like that. Like, again, I'm not a great player. I don't even know if I'm a decent player yet. I am just barely, as of this video, I'm just barely into Super Bronze. And kind of what's been happening to me is I'll go into Super Bronze and I'll get, like, you know, I'll lose and I'll drop back down to Bronze. So every time, every time I go into Super Bronze, I feel like, oh no, I'm not ready to be here. I'm just going to get knocked right back down to Bronze. And it's kind of like imposter syndrome, you know, where you feel like your wins are, because I've definitely had that. You feel like your wins are based on, oh, I got lucky there. Or like almost like you're afraid to take ownership of whatever little skill you've scrabbled together. It's a confidence thing. And it can mentally pull the rug out from under you.
Against each other in many different fighting games. And a lot of those matches look one-sided even if both players are roughly equal overall. That's because these players are usually not yet playing a complete, well-rounded game. Fighting games test you on your ability to do a lot of complicated things very quickly against another person. You need to get good at execution and reaction skills, game knowledge, and player reads in offensive, defensive, and neutral situations. Imagine we have two hypothetical new players. Player A has a B- in offense because they're a training mode natural and quickly picked up combos and pressure, but they've got a D in neutral because they're used to playing single player games where they don't have to think about feeling out another person's patterns. Player B has a D in offense and a B- in neutral because they came from Smash, so they're used to stuff like movement and positioning, but they're not yet used to stringing attacks together.
I feel like I'm more of the second type of player. I have had matches where I get thrown in the corner, completely ground down to nothing like that. But I've also had other matches where I get like poked out just, you know, constantly in neutral. I can't get anything going. So I've had both experiences, but also it hasn't happened a lot, but there have been a couple times where I was able to apply pressure and be the person to get somebody in the corner, and nothing they do like was working for them. And I've also had matches where I couldn't get anything going combo wise, but I kept having the other upper hand in neutral, so I ended up just poking somebody out myself. And so yeah, it goes back and forth. I don't know exactly where I am skill-wise, but I've definitely experienced both giving and receiving end of both of those kind of skill sets.
We'll assume that they're both equally bad at defense because most newer players don't really learn how to defend until later. When player A and B are matched together, either player A's offense will make player B feel like the game they're playing is about memorizing boring combos and set play instead of fighting like real warriors. Or player B's skill in neutral will make player A feel like the game is about poking and running away like a wimp instead of showing off your cool combos. Once they get everything to at least a C, they'll get to adapt back and forth. But until then, their matches are going to feel pretty one-sided, even if they're both relatively equal players overall. This is why matchmaking is hard in fighting games. If the matchmaker is accurate, you'll be winning and losing evenly, but they could all be hammer and nail games. Even at high levels, you'll often see highly lopsided matches between pro players, just because differences in playstyle and matchup experience can lead to huge blowouts. So get used to playing uneven sets, whether you're playing with a friend who's new to the genre, or playing Daigo in a show match. They're good for you, whether you're the hammer or the nail. But they're only good if you've got a learning mindset.
Do you have any bad habit?
No, I'm practically perfect in every way.
Most fighting game players know what it's like to be the nail, because you don't get good at these games without losing a lot. Sometimes, though, you get beaten so badly, you don't even feel like you really got a chance to play.
This might be the quickest CVS2 top four I've ever seen.
Don't worry. Here are two things you can do to make sure you
I will say, watching extremely high-level play, it can be reassuring to see people, like if you're watching somebody who's on the stage at Evo, you know, somebody who got out of pools at Evo, you can't make the argument that they're not good at the game, you know, because they're up on stage at Evo and you're not. But then you see that somebody get wrecked, and it's like, okay, it's not just something that happens, you know, down at the very bottom level where I am. It's like, it's a universal thing. And if you think that at some point you're just going to completely steamroll absolutely everybody you come across, then there's only I guess, a few people in the world who that's actually true for, and everybody else has to take their lumps.
You're learning. Pay attention to why you're losing and ask your opponent how to beat the stuff that's beating you. One of the beautiful things about fighting games is that ass whoopings come in several flavors. Playing footsies against Ricky Ortiz in CVS2, for example, was terrifying because her Vega made me feel like I wasn't allowed to stop defending, since I ate a crouching medium claw to the gut whenever I tried to walk forward. In contrast, when I played against Dominion in Street Fighter 4 pools at CEO one year, I remember feeling like every attack I tried was so predictable and easily blocked that pushing buttons just felt pointless. And when I played Marvel 3 with Clockwork, I remember feeling like I had spent 3 years playing the game without ever really learning how to block.
For those of you who've watched my stream, which is available there, down there, on the left side, some of my most frustrating moments where I'm like, come on, are definitely where I understand it's important to block, but then somebody's like you're not pushing buttons. And I've done that before where I hold up my hands like, look, folks, I'm not pushing buttons. And folks are just, you know, they're getting attacks in on me. They're starting combos at will. And it feels like my block isn't working. And that's frustrating. That's not a fun feeling. So, yeah, I can sympathize.
I have been bodied by each of these people and countless others besides, and I can tell you that each one is a different kind of scary that you too will come to recognize. The first time it happens, it could feel so shocking and so hopeless that you couldn't imagine learning anything from it. But as you get used to playing strong players, each beatdown will become a reminder to do small things differently. You'll stop using the attacks that they always punish. You'll see your movement and defense habits get exposed, and you'll change them up. Eventually, your fear itself can become a tool for
Another important skill to have to that end is not necessarily a skill that applies only to fighting games is, yes, you need to adapt, but you also need to be able to figure out what it is you're doing that's like, you may not even know what attacks are, like what the problem is. You may not even know how your opponent is playing. Especially if you're up against a character that you don't fight very often. Like, you'll see a distribution of characters online, and, you know, I've noticed I fight a lot of Akumas, I fight a lot of Kages, I fight some Gs. I've only fought a Minot once, and fortunately I was able to get a few matches out of that Minot player, so I had never even played Minot like in any of the offline modes. So I've learned very quickly, okay, Minot's a zoner, she's got that book and she's got that orb, and so while I was fighting this person, I was simultaneously trying to figure out the character versus Cody, and also at the same time trying to figure out, okay, kind of like an Excel, a condensed version of what's being talked about here, where I'm figuring out what the moves are, and I'm also trying to figure out how to get around them. Because normally I like to take my time, I like to wade in slowly, but that was kind of a trial by fire.
Diagnosing your problem. If someone makes you afraid to press buttons in neutral, it's because they have your movement and pacing down, so you'll have to throw them off by walking forward and blocking, or baiting a whiff punish attempt with a faster button. When they're blocking all your attacks, it's because your attack timing is predictable, so you'll change your timing to fish for throws and counter pokes. And when your defense is exposed, you'll have to stop mashing.
Okay, that's something that I think, if I could self-analyze a bit, that's something I think that I actually did well out of the gate that I didn't see a lot of other like new low-ranked players doing, was throwing a lot. I'm seeing it more and more as I go on, but that was something that I did out of the gate, and it was more effective than I thought it would be. But as I go up, I'm starting to, you know, get throw offsets more. People tech out. And so I realized that, you know, it's just something that most people seem to pick up later than I did, was throwing. But it's still in my toolbox, but I've kind of understood that it's more situational than my early experiences would have me or somebody else believe. So, sometimes it's not just an individual person you're playing against. It's your own play style that you need to adapt overall in general. As you notice patterns emerge.
And practice holding those mix-ups. The changes you make might not work at first.
And I really, really, really appreciate the style change from Pat right now. He's playing so much lamer than he was before.
They might not work at all. But through trying and failing, you will get stronger. Once you have an idea of why you're losing, you can speed up your adaptation process by asking questions. If you don't know how your opponent's tools work, or what you're supposed to do about them, or why their buttons are always beating yours, just ask them. I know it's more satisfying to figure out the answer on your own, but it's more efficient for both of you.
Do you know why this clip is here right now? Do you? Because I do.
To ask. This is not easy for everyone. There are some people in fighting games who are too proud to ask for help. For them, this is harder than losing. They have a much harder time with these games than the rest of us do, because they have to figure this all out on their own. And what if you're the hammer? I've heard strong players say they don't get anything from playing people who are too weak, and I get it. One-sided butt kickings aren't as fun as winning close matches, and if you're not careful, you can build bad habits by beating weaker players with things that better players will punish you for. But I've found that these sessions are valuable when I use them to experiment and explore. I play other characters to round out my game knowledge. I go for the hard combos. I try to parry things that I'd normally just block. Interestingly enough, this also applies to martial arts. John.
That's very interesting because if there was an option in Street Fighter V where you could just turn off seeing what rank the person you're about to fight is, I would activate that in a heartbeat. Because going back to what I was saying earlier about the mental game, if I see. And if let's say like I'm in super bronze right now, I get paired up against an ultra bronze or a silver. Already my brain is thinking, oh, they're just going to mop the floor with me. I don't stand a chance. This is going to go badly. You know, I'm already mentally defeating myself, which is bad. But by the same token, when I get bumped back down to bronze and it starts matching me against rookie players, you know, I think, okay, well, this, they might be fine, but mentally I'm thinking, okay, I probably stand a decent chance of winning against them. So I relax a bit, and I'll be honest, I enjoy it a bit more than I'm being relaxed, because it feels more like a game than work at that point, you know. But I totally understand what he's talking about when he says that you don't really have the potential to learn as much. You need a mix of higher level and lower level competitors for training anyway.
Danaher is a high level Brazilian jiu-jitsu coach who excels at describing the conceptual side of grappling. And in an interview a couple years ago, he said some really interesting things about skill levels in his sparring opponents.
People have a mistaken impression that you should always be training with the toughest guys. It's not true at all. I believe about 80 to 90% of your training should be with people who are significantly lower in skill level than you are.
I don't know if that 80 to 90% applies for fighting games, but I will say that I play a lot of weaker players during my Guilty Gear stream lobbies, and it's given me a lot of time to explore different parts of my game and focus on specific skills. Against players my level or higher, I can get too preoccupied with trying to prove I'm better than they are, even if it's just casuals. But against weaker players, my brain has more time to think and explore at a relaxed pace. I get to play the game by asking myself questions like, I wonder if this tool works in this situation, or what happens if I try to do A instead of B? Not only do I get better, the games also get a little easier for the other player too.
No!
I was so eager to, I wanted him to finish his thoughts before I paused it because I was the whole time I was like, yes, 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 because oh my gosh, I'm totally the same way. I was talking about as a bronze or a super bronze fighting rookies earlier, and I was talking about how I relax a bit, and I go easy on them. I don't not like out of pity or out of I don't have to go all out for this one. It's since I can relax a bit and I feel like I can experiment and my stuff has a greater chance of working, and it is different, experimenting against a human player than it is against just being in the lab. And I do things I would not try to do against somebody higher ranked than me. And I'm wondering if maybe I should try to, against every opponent, or at least most opponents, just try to be in that experimental mode, where, again, it's just another side of the coin of not being concerned with winning so much. Although you have to win in order to have a good barometer of where you are. But again, it's that mental thing. I wish so badly you could just turn off, seeing anybody's rank, just having it on faith that the matchmaking system puts you in the ballpark of the person you're going to fight, and that's all you need to know. And I wonder if I would actually do a lot better against people higher ranked than me if there's nothing for my brain to mentally deflate my expectations of winning, and freed from that shackle of rank and hierarchy. If I could improve a lot better treating a silver player the same way I would treat a rookie player, So, and also that would speaking to how you should primarily play against people weaker than you, that's kind of a luxury you would have in the higher ranks and not at the lower ones, since you can't, I'm sure the next time I go online, I'll get bumped down to bronze again. There's not that many people who are appreciably worse or less skilled at the game than I am. So I don't know how different it gets, or when, or if it gets different when you get into high silvers or gold or platinums or whenever it happens, And at that range, they're not really putting you up against lower ranked people anyways, which is where casual matches come in, right?
We don't get to have the good matches without the bad matches, because the bad matches are often where we learn the most. So, as a fighting game player, you have to do your best to learn from the sets where you're the hammer and the sets where you're the nail. Like everything else in fighting games, it's not easy and it takes a lot of practice. But when both the hammer and the nail are playing to learn, even the bad matches can get pretty good. I'm Patrick Miller for Core A Gaming. Thanks for watching. Read my essays in the video description for more tips on learning from uneven matches, and please consider supporting my Patreon and Twitch channel.
This hard reads was made possible by Raycon, who sent me a pair of their everyday.
All right, so that was Why Getting Bodied Is Good for You, and there was quite a bit to unpack there. I really enjoyed that video. I figured I would, but it also was refreshing to see that. Decisions I've made have seemed to be pretty solid as far as how I approach trying to learn in an online ranked environment. Patrick makes a good case for the utility of unranked fighting online, where you can get paired up against absolutely anybody. It's still a difficult thing to swallow a loss in which you just get pushed immediately into the corner. You can't get out of the corner. All you can do is hold back. And holding back is not working because they're mixing you up and, you get the KO and you don't feel like you learned anything. You felt like you were, as the fighting game kids say, you were free. It's not good feeling free. More frustrating is the feeling that I got nothing out of that fight. I didn't learn any new counters. I didn't learn any new techniques. I didn't get a chance to experiment. All I could do was react, and my reactions didn't work, and I didn't have a chance to figure out, why they didn't work. So I've been frustrated a lot over the past couple months, you know, and it's almost always been the source of my frustration has been I lost and I felt like I had no say in the matter. It's different when I lose and I know why. Like, even if it's something as simple as I couldn't get anything going, which is something I say a lot in a match, like when I feel like, and also I say it when I can sense my opponent, they were trying stuff and they couldn't get anything going because either I was, you know, I was what's what I'm looking for? I was poking them, I was stuffing their special moves, or I was stuffing their supers, or I was beating their combos, or blocking their combos, I should say. Successfully blocking their combos, successfully punishing, like everything was working for me and nothing was working for them. Whenever I'm in a situation where I'm on the flip side, I just try to remember that, where it's like, okay, I couldn't get anything going, but at least I had a chance to try stuff. That still feels better than getting pushed into the corner and just leaning back on the stick and hoping you block enough to get out of the corner. But anyway, thank you folks so much for watching this video. I do appreciate your time, and I'm still streaming fighting games. I'm going to be streaming fighting games for at least another month, and then I'll be evaluating whether or not I want to continue. That'll be like the 3-month mark at that point. So again, I didn't set out to like become, you know, an amazing pro fighting game player. I just wanted to give it some time and see if I could understand it better. And I already understand it a lot better than I did. So yeah, that's really what I'm trying to get out of this, is understand more, because I played video games since I was a little kid. Never really looked seriously at fighting games, and I wanted to rectify that. And as far as that goes, I'm succeeding. So yeah, this is a net win for me so far. So I hope you'll keep sticking with me, and I hope you'll keep watching my streams. You know, it's free to drop in. I do it 4 times a week. I try to. And I'll keep looking for content to absorb. And I hope you enjoy it, of course. So take care, and I'll see you next time.